Hi guys, welcome to Cryptids Canada. I hope everybody is having a great day. I am pretty excited. I've been waiting for this story to come in for a little while now. The gentleman had approached me and we've talked back and forth through email. And he really wanted me to tell his story, but it's not as easy as it sounds, because no matter how many times you tell somebody your story, they can tell it with all the best intentions, but yet miss a lot of important parts. So he finally took the time and wrote out his story, and guys, it's going to blow your mind. So how about you sit back, put your feet up, close your eyes, and come along for an amazing journey. Okay, hello, Miss CC. I really wish that you could have just told my story for me, but I understand that this is the way it has to be. I'm a little afraid that writing this out will bring back some details that I thought I had successfully buried, but I think that telling my story could maybe open the eyes of people who think that cryptids beyond Bigfoot are bullshit, maybe even believe that Bigfoot is bullshit. I'm not writing this for pity. Firstly, I truly want to warn the younger generation who believe that they are invincible. I am only here out of sheer luck, period. And secondly, to those who think that they are in control when they go out looking for these creatures, they're not. They know you're there long before you see them. If they aren't killing you, it's because they killed the idiot that was there before you. I believe these things, or creatures, are definitely from somewhere else. They're not made in a lab. We are food and easy pickings, and I believe the Earth is the dining room to the universe. Okay, so this is my story. I was a straight A student. I had a wonderful family, an older brother, a younger sister. My parents were apparently in love, until I saw my dad embracing another man. I really didn't care if he was gay. I just cared because it destroyed my perfect bubble. Or rather, I destroyed my perfect bubble. That if I'd just kept my mouth shut, things would have continued on the way they were. My dad told me after the fact that if I'd have just kept my mouth shut, everything would have been fine. He had no desire to leave us or my mother. Anyways, my parents now live separate, and they're alone now, and they're miserable. Anyway, the guilt which I carry for opening my mouth drove me to drink and to do drugs. I was 14 when I quit school and started sleeping on the streets, even though I had two homes where I was loved and welcome. I was nearing the end of my drinking and drugs because I met the perfect someone. She was new to the street life, so she wasn't ready to go home yet. Plus, she didn't have the home available to her that I did. As a matter of fact, her mother was a fall-down drunk and a meth head, but that part of her world is painful, and she very rarely speaks about it. Anyway, we live in a very small town that recently had some big factories come. And low-income housing was taken up by all the workers who followed the factories. So now our town was a host to homeless shelters. If you didn't get there by a certain time, you were literally out on the streets. I want to add that I had started tagging at this time, which is painting murals or initials on different spots with spray paint. This now brings you to my first sighting. I got to the shelter late, and of course the doors were locked, so I decided to go to an old abandoned building that Lydia, not her real name, had shown me. I knew she had left blankets and a pillow in a dumbwaiter. Lydia told me that that's what they were called. Basically, it's a 3 to 4 foot metal box that is used to take packages, mail, and food from one floor to the next. The dumbwaiter was found inside of a closet, and that's where Lydia left her pillow and blanket to be safe. So, the night that I'm writing about was the beginning of November. It was pretty warm out in the day, but at night it was bitter cold. My plan was to go to this abandoned building and sleep in the closet where Lydia had hidden the pillow and blankets. It would be cold, but I was out of the weather. I was on my way to the building, and I kept hearing this low, deep grunt and noise from the brush that lined the train tracks. I would have these flashes of terror, and I would stop and listen. I wouldn't hear anything, and then I would start to walk again. This happened about 4 times. The sound is indescribable. There was definite remnants of a dog growling, but much deeper and way louder. I got to the building, which was still mostly intact, meaning the homeless and hoodlums of town hadn't discovered it yet. There was still glass in the windows, and the doors were still locked and closed, except for 1 or 2 that were left unlocked at the back of the building. And that's how we would get in. There were streetlights at the front of the property that were still on, but the power to the building was off. It started to snow, and I was coming up to the building, and just before I opened the door to enter the building, I heard that loud growl and huff at the same time, similar to the sound of a dog that's just about to attack you. I looked behind me, and just for a second, as I was closing the door, I was sure I saw a large shape coming out of the woods in the brush. My first thought was, what the F? And then I ran up the stairs. I went to the first set of windows and looked down at the area. I stood off to the side for the longest time. There was nothing there, and I was starting to doubt myself, but it was dark in that area. The street lights were only on at the front of the building. I made my way to my closet and I got the pillows and blankets out of the dumbwaiter. I got myself covered up and curled up in the corner. It was freezing. I should have made my way over to a friend's house that I was thinking of doing when I heard another faint sound. I was listening closely and I cracked open the closet. The windows at the front of the building were about 6 feet away and I snuck over to peek out. That's when I saw what had been making those sounds. It was on all fours, and it was hugging the wall as it sniffed at the air. And then it would make a low howl and a grunt. It was really big, but I couldn't really tell what the heck it was. It made its way along the building and was getting very close to the area below where I was standing on the second floor. I was leaning on the window trying to get a good look at it when it got below the window, it stood up and stared right in my eyes. Its hands were on the wall directly below my window, and it was leaning its head back and looking right at me. It was a giant wolf. Its head and mane were as big as an African lion's. Its eyes were yellow-colored, and it did appear that they were lit somehow from inside. This is just a guess, because I never went back to measure, but this thing had to be 8 feet tall, standing up, and it came too close to the second floor windows. I jumped back, and this thing also jumped back, and I ran for my closet. I was petrified. I sat on the floor covered up with my blankets, really regretting that I thought I could pull off sleeping outdoors in the cold weather. When I heard that, I was no longer alone on the second floor. I could hear it sniffing the air. I had nowhere to hide. The area where I was one large open room except for that closet. I decided the only chance I had was to climb into that dumbwaiter and pray that it couldn't get into the closet. Then I remembered I had a couple of cans half filled of aerosol paint and a lighter. If I had to, I could use it as a weapon. It was the only weapon I had. I realize the story has gone on for a long time, but it's important for you to realize just how terrified I was and why it was making these horrifying sounds, almost like it had a cat and it was torturing it. It would come in close to the closet and start these awful sound effects. Then it started with the door. I knew it could get in the door because it came in through the back door. I've heard it said that these creatures love to terrify humans. Well, I have no doubt about that. I do also believe that they would have killed me if it had caught me. All of a sudden, I remembered the dumbwaiter. I quietly stood and assessed the situation. It would be tight, but it was made of metal. I grabbed my two cans of paint and my lighter. I put the pillow in and wrapped the blanket around me. Then I jumped up and climbed in. I quietly shut the door and sat there just listening. I also believed that once I got in the dumbwaiter, that it couldn't smell me as much. It was throwing its body against the door and screaming and howling at the same time. I think I must have lost consciousness out of fear, because the next thing I know, I'm hearing Lydia calling for me. I didn't say a word till she was in the closet. Then I whispered that I was in the dumbwaiter. She helped me out and asked why I slept in there. She told me I was lucky it held my weight, which I never even thought about. I tried to tell her what happened, but she honestly believed it was a dream, and then she mentioned that she worried all night because of the snow. I ran out of the building and was so thankful. I wanted to see if there was prints left in the snow, and yes, there was. We followed them, and it looked like they went around the building several times. Then it stood at the back door. There were prints all around. I could clearly see the front paws, or the hands, but they were made into fists and weren't paws like the back legs were. But I'm just guessing on this. Lydia agreed with me, but smirked and showed doubt that it was that big. That was my first and most terrifying experience. Lydia and I experienced the next one together. Yes, we are still together and no longer homeless. But that's a whole other experience. No name, please. Wow, I hope I gave your story justice. I know how difficult it was for you to write it down, but I promise you I could not have told it the way it needed to be told. So thank you for taking the time to do that. Maybe if you've helped some homeless kid out there actually listen that these things are dangerous, that they shouldn't be on the streets. You know, kids are meant to be at home. And please know that I understand there's different circumstances for each person, but maybe this just can bring a little bit of awareness to you. You know, if you have to be out after dark, you know, pair up. Don't be alone. And I don't know, it just gives me such a bad feeling, eh? Okay, guys, I think that's going to be it for tonight. Everybody take it easy. Have a great evening, and we'll see you back here in a couple of days. Bye for now.